And what they get is our elected employees.
The first lesson is from Jeremiah 23, verses 1 through 6. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, says the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who shepherd my people. It is you who have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you who have not attended to them. So I will attend to you for your evil doings, says the Lord. Then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the lands where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them, and they shall not fear any longer or be dismayed, nor shall any be missing, says the Lord. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. And this is the name by which he will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second lesson is from Ephesians 2, verses 11 through 22. So then remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcision by those who are called the circumcision, a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. Remember that you were at that time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall. That is, the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances so that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints, and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are put together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. The word of the Lord. Please stand for the gospel.
Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Brothers and sisters, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, some of you might know that a few weeks ago I went on vacation. I went back to the cities. I went to go see my family and catch up with some friends. I went to a Twins game. First time this year that I went to the Twins game. It's a little bit of a drive from here in Dawson to get to Target Field. But it was my first game. We were playing the Baltimore Orioles. It was a beautiful day outside. They had those brats and the onions grilling right there in front of you. Oh, it was so good. And it was a very relaxing time. It was a very restful time. So I was thinking about vacations, how much I enjoy them, how much I love going on vacation. And I want you to think about, when was the last time that you went on vacation? It could have been as recent as just a few weeks ago. Maybe it was earlier this summer. Maybe you went on a vacation last year. Maybe even a few years ago. Maybe it's been a little while since you've taken a vacation. And I want you to think about that time. Think about when you were last on vacation. Where did you go? Was it restful? Did you find it relaxing? Is there something memorable about that vacation? Something that stands out in your mind? Now, I want you to think about your dream vacation. Now, there's a couple of rules about dream vacations. First of all, money is not an object when it comes to your dream vacation, so it can go anywhere. Second of all, there's no time limit to how long the vacation can be. It can be as long as you want it to be because this is your dream vacation. You can bring whoever you want. You can leave behind whoever you want. I will let you tell which is which. So think about your dream vacation. Where would you go? What would you want to do on this dream vacation? Would it be a vacation where you are going about seeing different things, moving around? Would it be a vacation where you're sitting on the beach with one of those umbrella drinks? Would it be a vacation where you relax? Well, here's an interesting set of facts about vacations. These are facts about vacations in our own country. Americans take fewer vacation days than any other industrialized nation. And in fact, just last year, 41% of Americans did not take a single day off of work. Now, of the Americans who their employers offer paid vacations to them, only 51% of people actually use them all. That means that 49%, almost half of Americans, don't use the vacation time that's allotted to them. And those who study such things say that this adds up to about 500 million unused vacation days per year. So per year, that's like over a million years of vacation day. You begin to think about it and your mind just starts to, it's unfathomable. There are so many vacation days that are left on the table, unused. What's even maybe more astounding is that when Americans do go on vacation, 61% of them continue to do things for work. They continue to work while on vacation. Now, the U.S. is the only industrialized country that does not mandate that employers provide paid vacation days. Your employer is not required to provide you with paid vacation days. We compare this to other countries like Canada, which requires that your employers provide at least 10 days. Australia, which requires 20 days. Norway, 25. And even places like Finland, which require a whole 30 days of paid vacation per year. That's a whole month of vacation time. Who wouldn't want a whole month of vacation time? per year, you could really do your dream vacation. You might be able to accomplish your dream vacation with a whole month of paid vacation. I think our culture prides itself on our work ethic. We pride ourselves on being one of the hardest working, if not the hardest working country in the world. It's part of our American dream mantra. You work hard and you will be successful. If you work harder, you will be more successful. So, why are we talking about all of this? Why are we talking about vacations, dream vacations? Why are we talking about these statistics about unused vacation time? What does it matter if we don't take our vacation time? That shouldn't matter, right? That's up to the individual. Well, I'm not here to tell you how to use vacation time. But I also want to say that I don't think working hard is a bad thing. Indeed, I think that's what we are called to do. As Christians, our lives, we are called to work. We are called to work hard to share the gospel of Jesus Christ, to help those in need, to love our neighbors as ourselves. But when I was reading through the gospel this last week, this passage from Mark, something stuck out to me. And maybe it was because I just got back from vacation. I don't know, but it stuck out to me. Did you guys catch this? It's at the very beginning of Mark. Jesus said, or Mark writes, the apostles gathered around Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. He said to them, come away to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest a while. For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. Now, just a few weeks ago in our Gospel of Mark, we talked about Jesus sending out the disciples, bring nothing with you. Pastor Kendall had that huge sack of baggage on the overhead projector here. So Jesus, just a few weeks ago, has sent the disciples out to work. They are to proclaim the good news. They are to help those in need. They are to heal the sick, cast out demons, help the poor and the oppressed. They are sent out to work. And indeed, they have worked. And even as they come back to Jesus, they continue to work. In fact, they continue to work so much that some of them don't even stop to eat something. So, Jesus is the one who sent them out. So we're not saying that working hard is a bad thing, or that there is no work to do, or that we as Christians should simply just sit in our pews and not do anything in the world. That's not what we're saying. Indeed, there is work to be done. But notice what Jesus says today. Jesus says, come. Come away to a quiet place by yourselves and rest a while. Solitude, peace, rest, quiet. Jesus is basically saying, hey, you guys have been working hard, take a vacation. Take some time off, go be with your family and friends. Go focus on your faith. Rest a while. Relax. And Jesus isn't exactly being revolutionary here by telling us this. Jesus isn't the first person to tell us this. In fact, from the very beginning, back in Genesis, the first creation story in Genesis, when God is creating the world and all that is in it, on the seventh day, God rests. On the seventh day, God rests. God rests on the seventh day. Then again, in the book of Exodus, when Moses has received the Ten Commandments from God, the third commandment that we as Lutherans say is the third commandment is remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. It's a commandment. Remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. Now, usually we've interpreted this as you got to go to church on Sunday. Right? Remember the Sabbath. Sabbath, Sunday, go to church. Right? Well, the Hebrew word for Sabbath is Shabbat. And Shabbat means to cease, to stop, or to rest. It kind of changes how we interpret that commandment. Remember the Sabbath. Certainly we should still come to church, join in community with one another, but it changes maybe how we understand Sabbath. That we are to rest, to cease, to stop what we're doing. So God is basically telling us, remember to take a break. Remember to rest. And hold that time of rest in such high regard that it's a sacred time, that you don't allow your work to be infringed upon that time. Don't allow rest to become work. I don't think this really surprises us. I think we know this deep down, that we need to rest. In fact, more and more there's research talking about how many hours you're supposed to get per night, how many hours of sleep. And the interesting thing about sleep is that we know that we need it, but we're not exactly sure why we need it. If that makes sense. Scientists really aren't sure why we have to stop every so often and sleep. Why do we have to rest? Well, perhaps it goes back to the very beginning when God created everything and God rested. Perhaps it is just the way that God has created us, that we are creatures who are in need of rest. I think that despite the fact that we know that we need rest, we are still a culture that likes to be busy. We like to have things to do. And in fact, when we use those vacation days that we have, oftentimes we take a week off so that we can finish up some housework, or some yard work, or some other kind of work that we've gotten behind on. We use our restful time, our vacation, to catch up on other things. But today, Jesus reminds us of the importance of rest. We spend a lot of our time in church, and as Christians, focused on Christian vocation, the callings that God gives to each of us, the things that we are called to do in the world, the work that we are called to do. We spend a lot of our time and energy focused on how we can better accomplish the work that God has given to us. That we are to share the gospel, that we are to help those in need, that we are to visit the lonely. We spend so much of our time focused on these things, and we tend to forget God's calling to Christian vacation. You see, we're not just missionaries for the gospel, we are also vacationaries for the gospel. You guys like that word, vacationaries? I was pretty proud of myself. I can't wait until it starts like trending on Twitter and stuff. They'll probably use it in scholarly essays someday. We are vacationaries. We are people called by God to rest. We are called to take a vacation, and it is crucial that we take seriously this call to rest, because when we rest, we remove ourselves from our work. We allow ourselves time to reflect on our work. We allow ourselves to then become fully rested and restored, and then when we return to work, we can look at our work with new eyes, with clearer vision. In fact, Leonardo da Vinci, the famous artist, scientist, sculptor, everything. He was the true Renaissance man. Leonardo da Vinci once said, every now and then go away, have a little relaxation, for when you come back to your work, your judgment will be sure. When we take time to rest, it allows us time to be re-examine our lives. It allows us to approach our Christian vocations with a new lens, with a fresh vision, seeing things maybe we didn't see before. But this new vision, these new eyes don't come about if we don't take the time to rest. It never happens if we refuse to leave our work behind. In order for us as disciples, as children of God, to live out our vocations to spread the gospel, to help those in need, to love our neighbors as ourselves, in order for us to live out our vocations as missionaries for the gospel, we must also be vacationaries. We must be people of rest. Rest is a gift. It's not a burden. It's something that is graciously given to us. Something for us to enjoy. Something to breathe life anew into us. It's a loving, gracious gift that we shouldn't turn away. So is there still work to do? Absolutely. There is work to be done. There will always be work to do. But there is also rest to be had. So come, rest a while. Rest and be filled with the peace of God. Amen.